morning, everybody. Good morning. I hope you enjoyed Carol's service today. Just a few notices. There's an envelope. Okay, sorry, we've got to sing the introit first if we can stand. Goes to Ethelbert.
Only the collection in the envelopes. Our collection goes in our church.
Okay.
The collection in the envelopes goes in the
book. Okay, did you hear that? Yes. The money that's in the envelopes goes to Ethelbert. The collection on the day comes to us. Right, we're going to do the lighting of the candles, but before that, Linda is just going to explain what the candles are all about.
The Advent candles, meaning and explanation. The first Sunday of Advent's purple candle signifies hope. The first Sunday of Advent leads our hearts to hope. The purple colour symbolises royalty, repentance and fasting. This week is a time for us to reflect on what it must have been like to feel the depth of God's silence during the period between the Old and New Testament. The second Sunday of Advent's purple candle signifies preparation and peace. On the second day of Advent, we light the preparation candle. First, hope blooms as we realize the prophecies about the Messiah are true. Then we begin to prepare our hearts to receive the Lord Jesus. The third Sunday of Advent's pink candle signifies joy. The third Sunday of Advent brings us joy. The color pink represents rejoicing. We light the previous two purple candles and then light this week's pink one, rejoicing in our response to the good news, joy that our Messiah has come. The fourth Sunday of Advent's purple candle signifies love. On the fourth Sunday of Advent, we reach the culmination of love. The Messiah comes in love and righteousness. The angels fill the sky with the greatest news of love. The fifth white candle on Christmas Day. A fifth candle is added to the traditional Advent celebration and represents Christ. This candle is lit on Christmas Day. The color white stands for purity, light, and victory. Jesus is pure without sin, and because of his sacrifice, he makes us white as snow. He is the light in the darkness and the victor over sin and death. We have life because of him. Amen.
Today is the fourth day of Advent. We lit the purple candle. Love's memory is long. As we come to the last Sunday of Advent, we recall the many times we have been here before, with still so much to do and so much love left unexpressed. The Hebrew Bible lesson today recalls a promise to King David, which the Church has often understood to be fulfilled in the birth of Jesus. Love's promise is often kept in unexpected ways.
God's love endures forever, and the glory of heaven never leads to the divine. God's love is the only reality on which we can rely. Today we prepare for the grace expression of that love as we listen once more for the word in the words.
A reading from the prophet Isaiah, chapter 7, verses 10 to 16. Once again, the Lord spoke to King Ahaz. This time he said, "Ask me for proof that my promise will come true. Ask for something to happen deep in the world of the dead, or high in the heavens above." "No, Lord," Ahaz answered, "I won't test you." Then I said, "Listen, every one of you, in the royal family of David, you have already tried my patience. Now you are trying God's patience by refusing to ask for proof. But the Lord will still give you proof. A virgin is pregnant. She will have a son and will name him Emmanuel. Even before the boy is old enough to know how to choose between right and wrong, he will eat yogurt and honey, and the countries of the two kings you fear will be destroyed."
God's love endures forever. Through acts as simple and common as the birth of a baby, God transforms the world, and God's promises are kept. It is an expression of faithful love we anticipate and celebrate this day. It is that promise that brings light to our deepest night.
So, as we light the fourth candle in eager anticipation of God's greatest promise fulfilled, what else can we do but name this purple love? We sing the Advent song.
We ask your guidance. We ask for you, for your wisdom, for us to spread the good news and to only do it in truth, just like you are doing it in the scriptures. We ask humbly, Lord, accept our offerings. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
We are singing two songs. Please remain standing.
Peace and everyone.
morning, everyone.
Good morning.
The first reading is taken from Psalms chapter 80, verses 1 to 7, and then 13 to 19. God employed to rescue his people from their calamities. To the chief musician said to the tune of, hear us, O shepherd of Israel, you who lead Joseph like a flock, you who sit enthroned above the cherubim of the Ark of the Covenant, shine forth. Before Ephraim and Benjamin and Manasseh, stir up your power and come to save us. Restore us, O God. Cause your face to shine on us with favour and approval, and we will be saved. O Lord God of hosts, how long will you be angry with the prayers of your people? You have fed them the bread of tears. You have made them drink bitter tears in abundance. You make an object of contention to our neighbours, and our enemies laugh at our suffering among themselves. Restore us, O God of hosts, and cause your face to shine on us with favour and approval, and we will be saved. The next reading is taken from Romans chapter 1, verses 1 to 7. The gospel is exalted. I, Paul, a bondservant of Christ Jesus, called as an apostle, special messenger, personally chosen representative, set apart for preaching the gospel of God, the good news of salvation, which he promised beforehand through his prophets in the sacred scriptures, the good news regarding his Son, who, as to the flesh, his human nature, was born a descendant of David to fulfill the covenant promises, and as to his divine nature, according to the spirit of holiness, was openly designated to be the Son of God with power in a triumphant and miraculous way by his resurrection from the dead, Jesus Christ our Lord. It is through him that we have received grace and our apostleship to promote obedience to the faith and make disciples for his name's sake among all the Gentiles. And you also are among those who are called of Jesus Christ to belong to him. I am writing to all who are beloved of God in Rome, called to be saints, God's people, and set apart a sanctified life, that is, set apart for God and his purpose. Grace to you, and peace, inner calm, and spiritual well-being from God our Father, and from the Lord Jesus Christ. This is the word of the Lord.
Our gospel reading this morning is from Matthew 1, verses 18 to 25. The conception and birth of Jesus. Now the birth of Jesus Christ was as follows. When his mother Mary had been betrothed to Joseph, before they came together, she was found to be with child, by the power of the Holy Spirit. And Joseph, her promised husband, being a just and righteous man, and not wanting to expose her publicly to shame, planned to send her away and divorce her quietly. But after he had considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, Joseph, descendant of David, do not be afraid to take Mary as your wife, for the child who has been conceived in her is of the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you shall name him Jesus. The Lord is salvation. For he will save his people from their sin. All this happened in order to fulfill what the Lord has spoken through the prophet Isaiah. Behold, the virgin shall be with child, and give birth to a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which when translated means God with us. Then Joseph awoke from his sleep, and did as the angel of the Lord has commanded him, and he took Mary to his house as his wife. But he kept her a virgin until she gave birth to a son, her firstborn child, and he named him Jesus. The Lord is salvation. This is the words of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Our message today is all about trust. Our Bible readings today, all is about trust. You'll find our songs is all about trust. So today we trust. As a Christian, you have been told, trust in the Lord with all your heart. It's a famous passage from Proverbs that contains many, but it is not just a general statement. It has special meaning. To trust in the Lord with all your heart means that we need to rely on God's word, on his promises, on his wisdom, his power, and his love to help us on our day-to-day lives. We should trust the Lord because humans are tainted by sin, limited by wisdom, impulsive by assumption, and faulty by emotions. We are not always right, although some of us think that we are always right. We are reminded that our knowledge is partial and incomplete. We should we base our trust on what is partial, sinful, and destructive? Should we believe what another person is telling us? By trusting other humans, or would we rather say, let us trust in God? Because God is all-knowing, all-powerful, all-wise, all-loving, and plans our lives for us by guiding us and by keeping us safe. Isaiah says, 58 verses 11. The Bible tells us everything that we need to know about trusting God. Every single thing that I see now comes from somewhere in the Bible, put together to make sense to us. Some people take sections in the Bible and use it to explain something. Doesn't matter if it's good or bad. The Bible is only good. It's only truth. There's nothing bad about the Bible. We know that God only does things for the good of us. He doesn't change at all. He never lies. He is faithful in keeping his promises. Trusting the Lord begins with believing in Jesus, because Jesus is our salvation. The more we know God, the more we love him. The more we love him, the more we trust him. Isn't it the same if you love somebody next to you? If you meet a stranger, you don't know him, but the more you get to know him, the more you trust him, and the more you love him. It's the same with God. You can't just sit one day and say, fine, I've done it. I love God. It's a process that you have to work towards. Mm-hmm. You have to every single day work towards it. It's not something that just falls in your lap. It's like with any relationship that you have. You work towards it. But you know that God is truth. He never lies to you. He is faithful in keeping his promises to you. And he says to you, trust in Jesus. He is your salvation. Blessed is the man who trusts in the Lord and who hopes in his the Lord. For he shall be like a tree planted by the waters, which spreads out its roots by the river, and will not fear when heat comes, but its leaves will be green, and will not be anxious in the year of the drought, nor will it cease from yielding fruit. Blessed is the man who trusts in the Lord. We are like trees. Our roots takes to the ground. That's our foundation. That's our belief in God. What goes up is how strong we are. Are we evergreens? Do we have flowers that we put out? That depends on us and our belief, on the trust that we have in God. Because everything that God gives you is enough to nourish you. So your tree can grow and you can stand firm on this earth, evergreen, filled with flowers and fruit, because you are bearing it for God. Our Romans reading explains perfectly. It says, Paul, as a bond servant, A bondservant is one who is subservient to and entirely at the disposal of his master as a slave. So Paul is the bondservant for Jesus Christ. He is totally committed to Jesus. He is called as an apostle. An apostle is a special messenger, a personal chosen representative that is set apart, and his purpose is for preaching. And he's preaching the good news, and the good news is salvation. So we see, Paul says, God, I'm a servant. He's an apostle. His job is to go out there and to spread the good news. We are messengers for God. We say to God, we are your servants. We are here for you. Our job is to go out and spread the good news. Romans is telling us directly what we should do. We are set apart in our preaching. He promised us beforehand, because the scriptures are telling us, the good news regarding his son, who came to earth in flesh. Next week we celebrate Christmas, the birth of the baby. Jesus came to us in flesh. He was born a descendant from David, to fulfill prophets that came from the Old Testament. He has a divine nature, and according to the Spirit of the Holiness, he is a direct descendant of God. If we believe what the Bible says, we see the bloodline all the way down as it comes to Jesus. We see where Jesus comes from, how important it is. Your bloodline, where did you come from? How important is that to you as you walk through life? Are you a descendant of one of the Old Testament? You don't know unless you follow the bloodline. We know that God is the Son, the Father. He's the Holy Spirit. We know the truth in his words. We know that we need to trust God. Romans tells us all this, and it tells us the power, the triumph, and the miracle ways in which the resurrection happened, and what Jesus does for us. Romans today is very important for us in our readings, because we see everything that we need to see in Romans to tell us how we should be, what we should do, and how we should trust. We see that it ends with, I'm writing to all who are beloved. Because we are beloved. We are chosen. We are called saints because we are God's people and God chose us. And we are set apart from other people. Our lives are different from other people because we are set apart by God, because we follow his path. We are also receiving grace, and we receive peace because we give our hearts to God. So everything that we do, we are reminded that we go through Jesus. We are people from God. Our lives are set apart. We are apostles. We send special messengers out there, which we are. And we go out there and we give the good news of salvation, because that is the ultimate goal. You pass on the good news. And the good news is, if you believe, you can be saved. Nothing else is better. That is the news that we go out and tell. Our gospel reading today, Matthew, tells us about our human reaction to life. About Mary that gets pregnant. And Joseph that doesn't know what to do, but now he's a gentleman. And he decides, oh well, he'll take her with him, but he'll divorce her on the quiet. He doesn't want to embarrass her. That's a human reaction. We see in the Bible, it's exactly the same as our lives. We can take it and we can pull it into our lives every day, and we can say, but this is what happens. How would you feel if this happens to you? And then we see God sending his angel. And the angel telling Joseph, keep Mary. And this is the reason why. And we see Joseph trusting God. And he doesn't do what he wanted to do. He keeps Mary, and they live in our side happily ever after. because he trusted. He trusted the words that came from the angel. He was there when Mary gave birth. He was there to help raise Jesus in the young age that he had. His job was done because he trusted God 150%. Trust is not always easy for us. Most of us think we have burned our fingers by trust. We trust somebody next to us, and that person comes and burn our fingers. A lot of us think trust is earned. I want to see if I can trust you. Trust is earned. Oh, what do you think God says to you? Do you think God's trust needs to be earned, like that I need to you? Or do you just believe? Do you just trust? If that is the case, then why can't you trust the person next to you? Why does the person next to you have to show you that his trust is earned? If we all live the way that God wants you to live, everything that you do is done out of love. Everything that you say is the truth. Then why would you not be trusted? Makes you think. God says, trust me. God says, love your neighbor. There's nowhere in the Bible that says, you don't need to love. It says, forgive everybody what they do to you. Love your neighbor and trust. So basically, I have to trust everybody on this earth. Doesn't matter what they do. Because I believe what God says. Solomon wrote in Proverbs that we need to trust, and that is where it starts. Most of us face disappointments. We are taught from a very early age in our lives not to depend on others. Some parents even do that for the kids, to let them develop. They have to have courage. They have to be strong. They must be able to go out there in the world and not depend on people. Because we think we need to teach the kids that. So we go out there and we tell them, don't depend on others. Depend only on yourself. But living the life that God has called us means that we have to unlearn some of our lessons. That habits that we have that we take from youth up needs to be unlearned. And that one is believe. Trust one another, just like you trust God. It's a difficult one. People have burned your fingers. You have trusted somebody and they've hurt you. God says forgive and forget. So whatever I do now to you, 2 seconds from now you're supposed to forgive me. Can we do that? It's a challenge, ne? We need more than just words to commit to God. We need to cry out to him and to show him that we are dependent on him. Our actions speak louder than words. I can say the most beautiful things out of my voice, with my mouth, but my actions does not say the same thing. We need to be love everyone and everything around us, and that is the main thing. Our actions need to all about loving your neighbor, about speaking the truth, about never lying, about if you make a promise to keep your promise, because that's what God does to you. If we had the key of our lives with us, and we thought for ourselves, what will the future hold? And we depend just upon ourselves, where will we end up? That's why God says you don't know what happens within 2 seconds from now. Because if you knew how you're going to be a year from now, what would you do? God holds the key to our lives. He plans the future. The path that he wants you to go on is, our path is not smooth. Some people have more obstacles than others. Some people's life is much harder than others. We can't explain why. God is the only one that knows. We just have to accept life. We have to help each other. So yes, me with my very difficult path, I might need more help from friends. Support. Encouragement. but that is my path that God set out for me. And who am I to judge or to question? Because God says, forgive your neighbor, love him, show it with your actions, and trust. Sometimes the only way to live the life that God wants us is to live separate from bad influences. I think this is also difficult. Your best friend that you have in life might be the bad influence. And God says sometimes you might have to separate yourself from that bad influence because it might not be what is best for you. It is always easy to put yourself first, to put your job first, to put everything else first. We are supposed to put God first. But how many of us would put God first compared to putting yourself, your loved ones first? We should thank God for what we have. You know, you woke up this morning, you took a breath, your eyes opened, you see the flowers and everything behind you. It's things to be thankful for. How many people out there cannot see? You can see. How many people out there cannot hear? You can hear. Things to be thankful for. Things to be thankful for. Things to be thankful for is every single morning when you wake up. How many of us say thank you, Lord? You get up, get your day going, and off you go. You get in your car, you drive. How many people have cars? All the little things that we don't think about, that God says, be thankful for. It's easy to put ourselves first. It's not so easy to put God first. We need to be honest with ourselves. We need to evaluate ourselves. And we need to decide what we want for our future. What our behavior should be like. What our actions should be like. Because normally, this time of the year, we go through Advent. And every single day we walk towards Christmas. This is normally the time that we look at our lives. A lot of us decide, fine, we're going to make New Year's resolutions. We want to change so many things in the new year. This is a time for change. To explore us inside. To see what lessons we need to forget. What lessons we need to change to go forward. Sometimes it takes something bad to happen in our lives for us to open our eyes to see that we are really not so good as we think we are. It sometimes takes a bad thing for us to see where our bad habits are lying, that we need to see what we need to change. We all go through this every single day of our lives. Some days are easy, some days are difficult. The Holy Spirit guides us. We know that we never walk alone. We know that Jesus walks with us wherever we go. As we face each other every single day. See the difficulties. There you go, guys. You get distracted, all the noises. There you go. And God says, are you listening to me? Okay. We face each day, we face difficulties. We face distractions. God says, trust me. Only listen to me. Let everything else go in life. Put all your troubles at my feet. I will find a way to go with you and to find a solution. It might not be your solution, but it is a solution. Trusting God takes commitment. Wholehearted commitment. Just like Joseph said, trust God in our readings today. Because he believed and he trusted everything that he was told. He took Mary and he kept Mary. Just like Romans tells us that we are chosen, that we are saints, that we are special messengers to go out there and to give the good news. We are reminded today, Christmas is coming next week. The birth of Jesus, the celebration that we say on that day, we are reminded we need to walk with Jesus. We are reminded, change old habits. Forget your lessons that you have learned in life. We are reminded to trust in him with all our heart, just like Joseph, like Solomon says in Prophets, verses 3. Let me just get to Prophets. I will tell you what he says. So just a second. Because we were looking at Proverbs, and I made my mark. There's my mark. No, it's not. So yeah, so like we said with Solomon, he wrote and he says to us in Proverbs 3. He says, trust in the Lord and rely confidently on the Lord with all your heart, and do not rely on your own insight or understanding. In all your ways, know and acknowledge and recognize him, and he will make your path straight and smooth, removing obstacles that block your way. Do not be wise in your own eyes. Fear the Lord with a reverence, awe, and obedience, and turn entirely away from evil. We are today all about trusting in the Lord. Our readings from Romans, a verse from Proverbs, all that tells us today. Trust in the Lord. Amen. We are singing two songs, When We Walk with the Lord, which is Trust and Obey, and Jesus, What a Beautiful Name.
Thank you.
please join me in our closing prayer. God of love, give us a deep love for you, so that we can see the world as you see it. Feel the compassion you feel, and be the people who lives mediating your love to others. So open our eyes that we might see what the Good Samaritan saw that day. Grant us the insight to see the needs in others, the wisdom to know what to do, and then to do it. And so we pray for all those who are in many and various ways, have been stripped, beaten, and left for dead. All those in need. We pray for the children who must grow up in the most awful circumstances, especially for those starved of love, of food, of shelter, of security. May they receive the future that you have planned for them. We pray for those who might cross the road that we have to walk on, that we try to avoid, who have been exalted socially because of their race, their financial status, or their history. May the dignity that is in theirs be restored to them. We pray for those who need are much more than what we have, who do not know how to face tomorrow, because they require some action from us, because they suffered, maybe from war, from injustice, from oppression. We pray for all those who are suffering and in need. Open our eyes, Lord, that we might not cross the road where the human needs help. Give us a deep love for him, that we might be there to share in love and to work towards a better world, and that we might be what God, what you would like us to be, and that we can do what you want us to do, that we can be your servants, your messengers here on earth. We pray for everybody that is sick, that is on our prayer list. We pray for everybody that is in a hospital, that is healing. We pray for everybody that has lost a loved one. Lord, we ask for comfort for all of them. We ask for guidance and for healing and for strength, not just for the person in hospital, but for their extended families. We humbly ask, Lord, hear our prayers. Hear our prayer that you have taught us. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive them that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. We're going to sing our last song, Mary's Boy Child.
Thank you.
coming today. There is tea in the office if you would like to. I had a request that just after the service, if we can stay for 2 seconds, we would just like to pray for people that is in hospital. So that will just take about 2 seconds. Our benediction today comes from Romans 8, verses 58 and 39, and it says, "For I am sure that neither death nor life, nor angels nor rulers, nor things present nor things to come, nor powers, nor height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation would be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord." Amen.
Amen.
Isn't that a wonderful one? Go home and read Romans 8, verses 38 and 39 today. We are finishing up with singing "Christ Be Beside Me."